Before we begin this evening, there are a number of rules we would like to lay out for our participants and the audience. Particular questions will be posed to candidates based on the office they are seeking. Responses to questions will be limited to 2 minutes. When a candidate has 15 seconds remaining, the timer will hold up a yellow place card. When time has expired, the timer will hold up a red place card. Candidates are expected to finish their statements promptly. If they persist in speaking, the moderator, that's me, may cut them off and continue to the next candidate. Interruption of a candidate by another candidate or member of the audience will not be tolerated.
Thank you, Billy, and welcome everyone here to our forum this evening. I'd like to begin with a statement from Darlene Hicks, who is running for the Avery County Commissioner seat, one of three that are up for grabs in this coming primary election. Dear commissioners and constituents, thank you for the invitation to be a part of your Meet the Candidates event. However, due to prior commitments, I will be unable to attend. My understanding is you would like each candidate to introduce themselves, share their background, and perhaps an issue they feel are important for our community. My name is Darlene Hicks. I'm a lifelong member of this county and reside in Elk Park. I have served in several different capacities over the years. I attended Avery High School, Medlin Community College, and Gardner-Webb University. For the past 33 years, I've served in the justice system, both through the Sheriff's Department and the Department of Corrections. Currently, I work in the Department of Corrections through Medlin Community College. From 1998 through 2008, I served our community as mayor of Elk Park. The first issue I feel is important for our community is keeping the property tax rates as low as possible. I believe in our spurious economic times, our constituents need all the assistance we can give them. By working to curb unnecessary spending, we can help keep the tax rates low. Lower tax rates is also an incentive for new business opportunities for our area. Another issue I feel is important for our community is improving the relationship between county government and its constituents. For our county to thrive and be a place more business, more businesses and people want to live and be a part of, we have to find ways to increase people's desire to become involved. Input from the community is important for government to be effective. As commissioners, we can make all kinds of decisions we feel will benefit the community, but if they are not what the community wants, then it is a waste of time and resources. Thank you again for inviting me to participate. I regret not being able to attend. Sincerely, Darlene Hicks. We also want to read a brief statement from Maxine Laws, who's unable to be here tonight. Unfortunately, regrettably, she is not able to be here due to illness, and she sends her regrets in that respect. And the third candidate we want to read from is Mr. Tim Phillips, a candidate for the Avery Board of Commissioners. He writes, as a candidate for our county's Board of Commission, I'd like to take the time to thank you for the invitation to be a part of this evening's forum. However, as a member of the high school coaching staff, I felt an obligation to the athletes we serve to be present during the night's Western semifinal state basketball playoff currently being held at Avery High. I feel a deep sense of responsibility to these young men and felt it was important that I support them in this very important game. That being said, I also feel it's critical to support not only these young men, but all our county's youth. One of the most important issues we face in our county right now is the need for an updated high school. I feel the school board has a tremendous plan in place for the implementation of the update renovation of the current facility. The current plan calls for phasing the construction so that no mobile units will need to be purchased. Updating is better than a total renovation, and cost estimations at this point indicate that the entire project can be completed with no tax increases for our county residents. Also, I'm in total support of a freestanding building for horticulture, agriculture, carpentry, masonry, and auto mechanics, which is also a part of the current plans. That will give diverse paths for our children from which to choose. This discussion of youth and education brings me to another issue I feel is of utmost importance to our county, the need for more job opportunities. This need is great in our county and goes hand in hand with the educational opportunities provided for our children. Our ability to attract new industry in the future will depend upon the quality of our educational system and our ability to train those workers. To close, I'd like to say that all services and departments in our county are important. From newborn children to our elderly, all of our citizens need to be supported. From law enforcement agencies to the agencies which support us and our loved ones as we face the ending of life, all should be adequately funded to support our entire county. not only as a political candidate, but as a man of good moral fiber. I will never make empty or foolish promises that I can't keep. However, if I am elected, I promise that I'll make it my sincerest goal to be a good steward of the taxpayers' monies that I receive to operate our county government and ensure that all county departments are funded according to their need. Respectfully submitted, Tim Phillips. At this time, we'd like to also offer the opportunity for Mr. Thomas Webb to come forward. He is speaking on behalf of Dr. Rosemary Stein, beg your pardon, candidate for State Superintendent of Schools. Mr. Webb, the floor is yours.
I bring you greetings from my friend, Dr. Rosemary Stein, who is running on the Republican ticket for Superintendent of Public Instruction. She wanted to be here tonight, especially since she has a home in Avery County, but could not be due to a prior commitment in another county. If I may, I would like to read her qualifications and her six-point program for education in North Carolina. She is a former teacher of reading and of English as a second language. She is an adjunct teaching professor for three medical schools. She is on the North Carolina Partnership for Children, Smart Start Board, and is an executive committee member. She is a former Alamance County Community College trustee and chair of the curriculum committee. She is a former member of the superintendent's graduation task force. She is on the governor's early literacy task force. She is a former chair of the North Carolina Republican National Hispanic Assembly. She is a former member of the North Carolina GOP Central Committee. She is a member of the Minority Health Advisory Council. And she is the founder of the International Family Clinic in Burlington, where she has her pediatric practice and works with children and with their parents every day. She is also fluent in three languages. Her six-point plan, number one, is to replace Common Core with classical education. Number two, cut the ties to federal funding of North Carolina education and return education policy to North Carolina. Three, re-engage parents in the education of their children. Four, ensure our children are ready to learn on arrival to kindergarten. School ready means that the child has been taught to sit still, pay attention, and respect authority. Five, eliminate the intrusive gathering and mining of data of our children. And convert English as a second language to an immersion program. And I'll be through this minute. I won't be answering any questions for her, but you can go to her website, which is www.drrosemarystein.com, and send her a message and if you have a question or concern.
Thank you, Mr. Webb.
And she has also just published a book entitled Who Needs a Village? It's a Mom Thing.
Mr. Webb, you've reached past 2 minutes.
Okay. Two more things.
No, sir. I'm sorry. Mr. Webb.
Two of her slogans. Common Core out, common sense in. And let kids shine, vote for Stein.
Thank you.
Okay.
Resident of North Caldwell County. My wife and I first fell in love with the high country when we were students in Durham many years ago. Ever since then, we've been property owners in that county. Every day when we drive to our home, we pass by what we thought was a hay barn, but in fact, it turns out it was a one-room schoolhouse where several of our friends, now deceased, had gone to school. One-room school houses were very common in the early days of this state, where we recognized the importance of education and the necessity to support it. The founder of Appalachian State, Dr. Dougherty, understood that and was one who first saw the importance of state-level funding to level the playing field so that all of our children could have equal opportunities. This is a promise that we've been keeping, and North Carolina was known for its great schools. But unfortunately, in recent years, the legislature, in its wisdom, has seen fit to reduce funding, causing us to lose teachers, to lose our ranking amongst the nation and set us back from where we need to be to better, to further the American dream. And I'm running in part because I feel that we need to reverse that trend. We need to support fully our teachers and provide proper teaching aids. Starting, I totally agree with the previous comments, starting with preschool, because it's an awful lot to put on schools to expect them to make up for all the deficits in society. So I appreciate your vote. I'm not on the primary ballot because I'm unopposed, and that's my stop sign.
Thank you. You just passed it on to the ballot?
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to share with you tonight. My name is Deanna Ballard. I'm running for North Carolina State Senate. I was born and raised in Lincoln County, North Carolina. I know a few folks from that area have migrated up to the high country over the years. But I was born to the daughter of a logger and a public school teacher. So I've seen firsthand just kind of the challenges that our teachers are facing each and every day. I was the first one in my family to actually attend a four-year college. I went to Belmont University in Nashville, Tennessee. My parents instilled in me biblical values, a hard work ethic, and a determination to pursue those opportunities placed before me. So I am 37 years old. I have nearly 20 years of experience in service and leadership and just devoting my time and monies to working in the best interest of others. I've worked for President George W. Bush, Laura Bush, and then I've worked in the private sector, and I've also worked in the nonprofit at Samaritan's Purse currently and the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association. I have managed budgets from the first budget I ever managed out of college was nearly $150,000, and that has gone over the years now to multi-million dollar budgets and in my current position at Samaritan's Purse. So I do understand the priorities and the discipline needed in exercising conservative fiscal judgment. I'm running for office because I have a heart for service. The calling, the heartbeat of who I am is about service, the calling in my life. And I believe that I can serve you well, I can serve you with excellence, even better than previous senators. But I know I'm committed to that and determined to serve you. And one of you would be you, the district. You would be a priority for me. I would be intentional, be responsive, communicative, and be present. And tonight I'm here just asking for your support and for your vote.
I'm Ken Boham, and I'm running for the North Carolina Senate. Actually, I live in Lenore. I have for 21 years. But before going to Lenore, I was interim president at Mayland Community College. I spent 7 months here, so Avery County, it's not strange to me. It's good to be back, and in fact, I come often and play golf when there's not 7 feet of snow on the grandstand and when the golf course is open. I am a Christian candidate. I am pro-life. I have been a Republican all my life. Now, some people may think that's strange that you could spend 40.3333 years in education and be a Republican, but I'm actually living proof that it can be done. I've been the president of Caldwell Community College and Technical Institute for 21 years. This June 30, I will retire, but I'm not dead. So, what I'd like to do is continue what I have been doing for the past 40 years, especially for the past 21 years, and that is work for people in this district in promoting opportunities for education, economic development, and workforce preparedness. Those are issues that are critical to this state. Those are issues that are critical to Avery County. And if you vote for me, and I am elected to the North Carolina Senate, rest assured I know where Avery County is. And if you call me, I will call you back. And if you email me, I will email you back. And if you invite me to show up, I'll stop.
Thank you so much. I'm Representative Josh Dobson. Thank you to the Journal and all the sponsors of tonight's event. Thank you all for taking the time to be here, because what we're doing here matters tonight, and I appreciate your concern and your interest. Just the location itself is a special place for me, because I'm not going to tell you how many years ago, but many years ago, I roamed these halls here at this middle school. This is where I went to school and sat in this cafeteria many times, in these classrooms many times, and I see at least three teachers that I've had in my time at Avery Schools that are in the audience tonight. And it's special for me on nights like that. So I appreciate the opportunity to be here. I'll just say this. Out of the issues that we address, I've been in the State House for 3 years, 3.5 years, from healthcare to education to energy to social issues, the conservative values that we hold dear, everything across the board. I try not to look at things through an ideological prism. I try to look at things to say not what is best for the leadership in Raleigh, not what's best for some other member or some other district. Every issue that's come across my desk, I'm trying to say what is best for Avery County. And that's sometimes with the leadership, sometimes it's not. But my main focus is to say what is best for Avery County. I'll leave you with a quick story. I heard a congressman one time say when he was being pushed in Washington, D.C. to vote a certain way, when they were saying, "Congressman, we need you to be part of the team on this one." He said, "Guys, I appreciate what you're saying, but my team's back in Western North Carolina." And I heard that, and I said, that's the kind of representative that I want to be, and that's the kind of representative that I've tried to be over the last 3.5 years. I would appreciate your continued support as we try to move Avery County and Western North Carolina forward. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Martha Hicks. I've been a servant for the county going on 8 years. We have two commissioners out in my audience that I'd like to recognize, Mr. Blake Vance and Mrs. Faye Lacey. We would like to thank you for being here tonight with us. And I have a school teacher that taught me in Newland High School, Mr. Thomas Webb. But we won't keep adding a lot of years in there. But I was very fortunate when I graduated from school. I got to stay in Avery County and work, and I feel that was really a pleasure to get to work in Avery County. I worked for Martha Guy at Avery County Bank for 17 years, and when I first got out of school, I went to Glen Raven and worked 10 years, and then I run over the county line a little bit and worked in Montcalm County for 10 years as a designer for corn and wire baskets and as an instructor. And I've been very fortunate in Avery County. But I'm seeking re-election my third term. A lot of people has asked me why. I am very involved with county business right now, and I'd like to continue to keep working. I've worked with the Veterans Park. We're getting really started on that. We've got a decision to make on the schools. We've got a decision to make on our recreation department. And there's just a lot of things that we've been working on that I would like to continue and be your servant.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Glenn Johnson, running for county commissioner. I was county commissioner for 6 years, from 2018 to 2014. And I'm going to address right up front why I'm running. The reason I'm running is this. I feel like the county commission board has taken a turn that I'm just not happy with. And from what I hear out in the public, a whole lot of other people are not happy with it either. But I do want to say that I'm a United States Army / Vietnam veteran. I am the only veteran running. There are currently no veterans on county commission board. In fact, there's not been a veteran on the county commission board since 2006, other than me, for those years that I was there. I'm a graduate of Clayton Business College, and a graduate of Mayo Community College. I hold associate degrees in business and criminal justice. Another reason I'm running is, I will give you the facts, folks. I believe in facts. There's too much going on. All you have to do is listen to our presidential campaign. Too many people telling people what they want to hear. I will absolutely always tell you the truth. It may not be what you want to hear, but it will be the truth, and I will give you the facts. And I will be honest in all my dealings. As my cards say, I will take my integrity and that of the Board of Commissioners and Avery County at all costs. Now, addressing some other reasons that I'm running, Avery County High School is nearly 50 years old. Back in 2012, there was a committee appointed, and now we're right back to square one. So, James, tell me I have 15 seconds. I have some other issues, but maybe we'll address those a little later.
You don't care how strange it is. My name is Woody Young, and be on the ballot. Woody Woodhull Young Jr. I don't know what to tell you. I'm Woody Young. I'm the fifth of seven generations in Avery County, long before Avery County became county. I retired from the Avery County school system in 2007. I work maintenance. I know probably as much more about the existing school buildings than most of the people on Maintenance Street. There's three of the old guard, three of us still living and know these old buildings. I'm, of course, a lifelong Republican. I registered as a Republican at age of 18. I've never failed to vote in the primary or run off for a general election in Avery County since that time. I'm sorry, but I'm very boisterous, I'm open-minded, and I speak in peace. And Mr. Webb also taught me. I'm glad for our teachers in Avery County. But really, I don't know what to tell you. My wife of almost 41 years was raised in Cranberry. We have three children. Our oldest daughter, both my wife and both of our daughters, complete education came from Avery County, elementary school, high school, and Legion Credit College. Our son also, his education is Avery County. Avery County High School, Mother Community College. And some undergraduate work at ETSU. But I will answer your questions.
Good evening, everybody. And as Josh said, thank you all for being here and for our sponsors for this. It is very important that you all hear what we have to say, what we stand for. My name is John Green. I'm currently the chair of the Avery County Board of Education, and there are three of us running for three seats, so we're actually running unopposed, which is nice for one time. But with that, I still thought that it was important, and for at least one of us to come, so we decided that I would come and just tell you kind of where we are and what we stand for at the Avery County Board of Education. I'm seeking my third term as a member of the Avery County Board of Education, and during my first term, we came up with a vision statement, which was that Avery County would become a model of rural education. A couple of years later, we had Kathy Aldridge and I came on at the same time. We had Dr. Bob Clark, Mr. Steve Smith, and Mr. Keith Tutterow came on. We tweaked that a little bit, and we would become not only a rural model of education, but a national model of education. I have to brag on my fellow board members, and that's one reason that I want to have such a well-functioning board. Each one brings a different talent, but equally important talent, to the table. And each one is committed to providing the Avery County children with the best possible education experience that we can give them. At the same time, we want to give stewards the best money. The Lord has blessed us beyond measure. We've made great strides in becoming that national model of education. We were the first school system in the nation to become to have a one-to-one initiative, which means every child got a computer. We've got a lot of work to do still, and so that's why I'm running, so we can, a lot of folks mentioned the high school, and that is our main priority. We do need to replace and work on our high school a lot. So I'll pass this on.
Good evening. I'm Becky Hager-Strider. I'm a district court judge. I was appointed a year ago, and I am asking for your support in November for me to keep my seat, because I'm letting you realize you. I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. I am in a lifelong resident. Almost 30 years ago, we had two sons. I was fortunate enough to try cases in front of the Honorable Robert Lacey, and I learned so much from him. That's a FaZe late husband. He's a tremendous jurist, and I feel privileged that I got to practice before him, and I strive to have those same principles that he did, because he had such an impact on so many young people's lives. I want to tell you that I have been practicing law for 28 and a half years before I was appointed. This will be 30 years since I graduated from law school and been practicing. I feel like I have the experience. I practice primarily in district court, which is criminal court, child custody, juvenile court, which includes abuse, neglect, dependency, as well as delinquency. It's really the court that touches most everybody's lives. That's where I say where the rubber meets the road. And it's an important thing. I am conservative. I was raised Republican. This is a nonpartisan race, but I will tell you that I am a lifelong Republican, as well as having solid Christian principles, and I believe in employing those Christian principles on the job, which you bench, in making these decisions. I want to ask you to please consider supporting me for re-election in November. I appreciate your support. I appreciate you being here. I appreciate your prayers most of all. Thank you.
My name is Josh T, and I am running for district court judge as well. I'm an attorney in Boone, North Carolina. I'm a resident. I'm born in Boone, North Carolina, resident of Watauga County. I'm a graduate of Appalachian State University, Wake Forest University School of Law, and I've lived and worked in Boone for the last 8 years, almost 9 years. With my wife, Jen, who is the Watauga County Senior Center Director and on Boone County Council. My law practice focuses on district court practice as well, primarily defense work. I do criminal defense, I've done child support work, abuse and neglect dependency cases. I'm one of two contract juvenile defense attorneys in Watauga County, and also practice in Avery County. In addition to my courtroom work, I'm a board member for the Mediation and Restorative Justice Center, and that's a nonprofit organization that serves 11 counties, provides mediation services as well as sentencing services and drug treatment court program in Watauga and Avery County. In addition to that, I'm on the Juvenile Crime Prevention Council, which is it's a committee that monitors and allocates pass-through funding from the state to fund certain juvenile programs, community resources to address juvenile delinquency, reduce recidivism, and to address at-risk behaviors with youth in our communities. I believe that through a strict adherence of the law, treating everybody equally with respect, that you can see consistency and dependability. And I believe that through an efficient and effective use of all resources, we make our court system work better and our law enforcement efforts more effective as well. Thank you.
And proceed to the questions that we have, and we will be starting with this question for our state representatives. What are you going to do, whether on a regional or state level, to create jobs for young people to return to once they leave their homes to attend college and graduate?
like me to read that again? You can take, again, take 2 minutes, answer the question as you feel, and then pass it on. Would you like me to read that again?
No, okay. No, that's a clear question, and it's an important question. The issue is, as I've thought a lot about this, as I've watched what's happened over the last 20 or 30 years, and particularly in Caldwell County where I live, what's happened to the jobs that disappeared overseas. Those jobs are not coming back, no matter what people tell you. And I agree, I'm going to tell it like I see it, and it may not be what you want to hear, but the only way we're going to get jobs for people is to prepare the workforce for the jobs of the future. I recently heard one of the Republican presidential candidates talking about they didn't want to go forward, they didn't want to go back. I don't understand that. That isn't going to work. It can't work for us here. We need to invest, and we need to invest in education at all levels. If the children don't have proper background in their homes before they start kindergarten, they will never catch up with their fellow classmates. So we need a universal preschool. We need strong kindergarten, strong secondary and primary and secondary education, and then a great system of community colleges and universities to educate people, train them for the jobs of the future, not look backwards.
I think a key element in actually creating jobs is going to start with a lot of innovation and entrepreneurial spirit. It's going to have to come from personal responsibility, folks stepping up, not afraid to take risks and to be courageous. And I think we can do that and help them do that by reducing a lot of the regulation that's already there in order to start a business. I mean, 98% of the employers in North Carolina are small businesses. So I think we need to come up with ways that we can help them foster security and raising and getting the capital they need to start a business. I think we need to provide them an environment where they feel safe and secure in order to put themselves out there to foster all this education that they've attained. And I think a lot of times in the communities that I've been in recently and just all over the district, their heart is a lot of young people want to stay, and they want to stay in their area. And so I think a lot of it's just going to be encouraging them to kind of think a little bit outside the box and to really pursue their passions. That's there and available for them, and I think we can encourage that and be a part of that too.
It's not actually that what I will do, it's what I am doing. In one particular part of the district, we cut the unemployment rate in half in Caldwell County. Hundreds of thousands of square feet of abandoned furniture factories are back up and running with new industries. Just last week, the governor was in Lenore, lighting the announcement of Crystal Engineering that is creating 82 jobs, $20.9 million worth of infrastructure. I was on the team that brought that company to Caldwell. What we need for Avery is infrastructure and roads. We need to make sure that high-speed internet is here, not only for education, but for economic development. Not only do we need that, we need natural gas. We need those things that you can use to bring people. Now, the big elephant hunt of bringing a big industry in is not the norm right now. But there are ways to bring small businesses into areas. We just need to make sure the infrastructure's here. This is a fabulous place to live. This is a beautiful place to live. This has got everything that people would want in terms of coming to an area. You just need to take all the things we have, bring them together, get people working together, elected officials, non-development folks, and we can make sure people will come to Avery County. That's how we put people that live here back to work.
I'll be honest, there's not a whole lot in Raleigh that keeps me up at night. We tend to think of ourselves as significant, but really it's a lot of what we do is not significant. But there are three things that keep me up at night with regard to economic development and jobs and just in general for what's going on in the state. Some of it's already been touched on. One is broadband access across Avery County. I had a legislator from a more urban area stand up and talk about on the floor how we need to have more online classes in high school. We need to have more things like that. I said, that's great. We'll be number one. Let's just get broadband access across the county first, and then we'll talk about doing those types of things. So that's the first thing. The second thing that keeps me up that I'm very concerned about is rural health care. We have to do everything we can to preserve and protect our rural hospitals and rural health care, because without that, the thought of people of Avery County having to go to Johnson City or Boone or Asheville or some other place to receive health care because we've not done our job at the state level to make sure we have adequate rural access to health care in Avery County is something that's just unacceptable. And that leads to jobs. You can't have a sustainable economic development plan if you don't have good access to health care. So we have to focus on that. And the third thing is public education. I never understood why you couldn't be pro-life, pro-gun, and pro-public education too. But that's what I've tried to be, and that's what I'm being. Any success that I've had is because of the training that I got in the Avery County Public School System. And without that, I would not have had the opportunities that I've been blessed to have. So instead of tearing it down and sending money elsewhere, we need to strengthen public education in Avery County. Work with the great school board that we've got, and as far as I'm concerned, the best superintendent in the state that we need to continue to work with to strengthen public education, not tear it down.
Thank you very much. Our second question will be addressed to our county commissioners and candidates. Since early 2015, the position of Director of Economic Development for the county has been eliminated. What is your vision for bringing employment to our county? And how can we use our current resources to entice more businesses to invest their time and resources in our area?
Well, I will tell you that we have been working on getting broadband into Avery County. We have it at the line where Maitland Tech is, and we have had several meetings, and we're going to have to be getting some funding to back this. But I think if we get more internet service in the county, I'm sure it will create some jobs, because a lot of people work from home now. And I think that's one of our biggest priorities. And to give the children computers, but they don't have internet service at home. And if most parents was like I was when I worked, you don't have time to go sit at McDonald's or Hardee's or somewhere for them to do their homework. And I think that's one of our most important things, is to work on the internet, and I'm sure it will help in our schools, and it will help our county in jobs.
Mr. Johnson?
Well, to answer the question first, I think what I would be looking to do as county commissioner would be to appoint an economic development commission made up of a cross-section of Avery County, people from different walks of life, business people, entrepreneurs, that could come up with some, get their heads together and come up with some ideas on economic development. I don't see that there's anything more important, really, than economic development. We need to be trying to keep our young people here. We need to be also trying to attract young, smart people to come in here. And you know, when I was commissioner, I went to several economic development seminars in Raleigh. They were available to all the commissioners, and I learned something called placemaking. The time was when you build a big BMW plant or some other type of large plant, and the people came there for the jobs. Nowadays, you create the place that people want to come and live, and they create the job at the beginning. So that's what they call placemaking. And I think that's one thing we need to be looking at, creating the place that people want to come and live, new people, as well as creating a place that our own young people want to stay here and live and work. And how you do that is with, as Mr. Dobson said, is with good education, good health care, good infrastructure. We lack the three R's: road, railway, and runway. We're 30 miles from the nearest interstate. We're 50 miles from the nearest commercial airport. So there are challenges there. The day of getting a large plant to come to Avery County is probably not going to happen, but we need to be working on the things that we have and looking for new small business to come in here. I would never turn down a large plant, but it's very challenging.
Then let's be honest, Avery County is not an industrial county. It really never has been, probably never will be with all the industry that's leaving the state of North Carolina. I think, personally, the best thing we can do for economic development would be to build on what we already have. Tourism county. We have several small businesses, and we have the greatest natural beauty anywhere in the state of North Carolina. And I really think that these are three things, if they're worked on, that we can take advantage of people coming to Avery County, and we can take advantage of people wanting to be in Avery. Small businesses, I'm a little different than anyone I've ever heard talk about economic development, because I think the best way thing we can do is to see what we can do to promote the small businesses that we already have, to see if they can grow and maybe hire other people. And yeah, we truly do need internet service across the entire county.
Earlier that we had talked about doing a phased-in process.
next will, next question will adjust, address the judicial candidates. What would you consider to be the most prominent legal problem facing our district? And in your role on the bench, how will you be able to address it?
I think we have several. One of the most insidious problems we have is drug problems. And there's a terrible meth problem that's going on. And I think what is important as a district court judge is you give these defendants a fair trial, that you enforce that law, that you back up your law enforcement officers, and that it also trickles down to the families, because that's also the what's been occurring. Departments being able to refer people out to mental health agencies. As a district court judge, I think it's up to us to watch out and make sure that if somebody has been referred to a program that hasn't worked, then you look for something else more than to do instead of keep sending them back for that. Sometimes it's appropriate, sometimes it's not, but it's on a case-by-case basis. And that's one of the things that that you have to really look at is the circumstances as they fit with each one, because you're not going to have the same situation with each criminal defendant or with each case that comes to the DSS or with cases that could even go through the family law courts, because you're going to have those issues too. That one of the things as a district court judge, certainly you can look at taxing the cost to the defendant as part of the cost for that to help defray some of that, because I don't think that we want to break our counties with having to fund extra. So I think that where it's appropriate, where people can't afford to pay, then it needs to be apportioned to them. Certainly where those that cannot, then we have to refer it to the agencies and hopefully that it can be addressed. Thank you.
Well, mental health issues, like substance abuse issues, they often get referred into the criminal justice system or to Department of Social Services as a last resort. Unfortunately, a lot of our law enforcement officers, prosecutors, defense attorneys don't have the training to recognize us for what they are. So one thing I think that would be very valuable is partnering with some of the local mental health providers, either the local bar associations or the district bar association, or some of the state resources that are available for education, to do some in-services to let the court personnel, both sides, and also the judges, know what resources are available in the mental health system. One of the problems with the mental health system is that the funding of it. A lot of counties don't have adequate mental health resources, and the ones that do, a lot of them are private pay, and a lot of folks can't afford it. And you can refer it through certain programs, but if it's cost prohibitive, then you're really setting up somebody to fail through the court system. Housing somebody in local confinement is expensive, and what you tax to these individuals, when you tax it as a condition of probation, you tax it to them in jail, you tax about $40 a day. That's the most you can get. It costs substantially more than that in housing. So by not providing the funding to the local resources, you really just pay for it another way. But I feel like that the court, through partnering with other programs and through doing in-service training for the personnel, can more adequately address those issues and effectively use those resources.
Thank you. Mr. Green? The Avery Journal Times reported in January that a grant was secured to assist in the purchase of multiple security cameras for placement in Avery High School. What measures would you take in your role as a school board member to ensure that our children are safe, not just in the high school, but in every county school?
Well, thank you, Dave. We have made quite a few adjustments so we can do that, as far as putting cameras at the doors, making sure doors are locked. High school, you mentioned not only that, but there's about, you could probably answer this better than me, 40 or 50 entrances to the high school. The high school was built at a time when we didn't have to worry about security so much. But if you've ever been in the high school, if you've ever been a freshman at Avery County High School and tried to find your class, you're always going in circles. That is just not conducive to good security. Anybody can hide around that. It's always best nowadays to have straight halls. And that's one thing that we want to address, as far as when we renovate, and not only renovate, but we want to have a lot of new construction with the high school too. So making sure that we have good line of sight. The Avery County Sheriff's Department has been wonderful to help out. We have a resource officer that we didn't have only just a few years ago. County commissioners did provide money for us for those cameras, and that does alleviate some of that problem that we have at the high school. Also have that at the elementary schools, but so we have taken other security measures to make sure whoever comes, they come through that front door, they have to be identified before we let them in. They have to go through the front office and before they can get on back into the school. With that said, there's always the possibility of something, so we're always trying to watch out to see what we can do to improve that. But so far, the cameras have helped. Having the cameras at the other schools and just the process that people have to go through to enter our schools has been tightened up, especially in the past 4 or 5 years. We've gone to extreme measures, and probably we can always do more to make sure that our children are safe. We keep them safe first, then we can educate them.
For our Board of Commissioners, the issue of what to do with the current Avery County High School facility has been a subject of great debate. What would you do as County Commissioner to ensure that every student in Avery County has the learning environment that they deserve? Specifically, would you support repair, renovation, construction, or a combination of the three at Avery High School, and why?
One thing I want to mention that I did, I'm going to go back to one industry that we had in Avery County. It would probably be the largest that we always seem to look over the commissioners you ever mentioned, for the Christmas tree lunch. Now, for the high school, I have seen attentive plans for what the Board of Education wants to do with the construction of new classrooms, which, yes, that's what I'm in favor of, is building new, partially renovating with what the Board of Education's plan is, because really the safest school that we had for a long time was the new Riverside Elementary School, because it had straight hallways, limited access, and that's one thing I know that has been looked at in what they plan to do with the high school. And yes, the plans that I have seen, if I would support what the Board of Education is wanting to do. Because if you go to just the remodeling, you're talking astronomical cost of money to an old building and mobile classrooms. Where you going to put them? Who's going to pay for them? I mean, the expense would be astronomical. But I think the Board of Education has done their homework. The plan that they have in place is the best plan that could be they could come up with.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Johnson.
Well, in 2012, a committee was appointed, and after some 16 meetings, the recommendation of that committee was 2.5 years, 16 meetings, consisting of people from the Board of Education, people from the from maintenance, people from the County Commission Board. The recommendation was a renovation / new construction of the high school. As Mr. Green mentioned, it was to be phased in. Phase one would have been building out the where the steps are now at the high school, out to street level, some 30 classrooms, I believe was correct, John. And move the students into those 30 classrooms and then take it pod by pod and do these renovations. Now what we have over there, according to the Department of Public Construction report, is a building that is in pretty good shape for the shape it's in, I guess, for its age. But the infrastructure within that building is the major problems. The electrical, I understand, if you cut the breakers off over there, they probably won't come back on. Those breakers are not available. Sewer system, antiquated, having to jet those lines every 6 months now, I'm told, at great expense. It was done back in the summer. It was done at Christmas break, and it will be done again. summer vacation while students not present. The reason it requires renovation slash new construction, you've got to have a place to put the students in order so you can renovate the rest of the building. There are many issues, air quality. All this has to be done while students are present. It is a little bit like the courthouse was, except on a much grander scale.
Well, I was in a meeting today discussing renovation, new school, with two constructors, and the main thing is that we're looking at is a DPI report from the state. And if you don't know what the cost is to repair something or to build new, we're trying to figure out which way will be the best. Now, in that DPI report, they mentioned the sewer, they mentioned the lighting, they mentioned some of the construction in it was bad, and we spent all morning long talking with the noise and another company, and they're supposed to give us a bid on what the DPI report was. They're supposed to come back Friday or Monday morning and have us a bid on how much it would cost to fix all those repairs. And then we can weigh out the cost. Now, for me, I'm like Glenn. I worked with Glenn as a commissioner. I've worked with Mr. Green on the school board. We have a good connection together. Some schools, they can't even have a meeting together, but we're very fortunate here in our county that we work together with our school board and commissioner board. And we will probably, we can't get it out to the public this coming meeting, which is in March, but in May or in April, we'll be ready to present something to the public to know the cost for both jobs.
Thank you, Ms. Davis. At this point, we are going to break for 10 minutes, and then we